Okay. We deconfected that one.
Okay, welcome everybody.
Hi.
Okay. Okay, this is our morning. I hope you had a good evening in the clear light. Okay. Oh, I'm going to talk first. We're going to meditate first, then I'm going to talk, then Bob's going to talk about compassion. So, any questions about the meditation that we did yesterday?
It was great.
Everyone knows what they're doing. Okay. All right, so find a position that you can maintain. Try to hold the position. Try not to move unless you are experiencing, you know, real pain. Don't. It's not a torture thing. But it'll get a little uncomfortable. Try to stay with the uncomfortable sensations, just noting them in their raw form, should they come. And let your eyes close. You can open them if you would rather, but let them close if that's okay. And just first sit back into your body, your spine relatively erect, the thread pulling from the top of your head. Letting the breath just do what it wants to do by itself. Don't force the breath in any way. And just let the attention open. Back and forth between the sounds, opening and opening and widening, that idea of infinite space, infinite consciousness that we talked about yesterday. You don't have to get to the infinite, but you can widen your awareness. Use the silence and the sounds that filter in as a way of just settling into yourself. Feel the mind reaching out for the sounds to identify them. Notice that, but consciously relax back into yourself. At some point, come to the sensation of the breath. Use the breath as something to really focus on. Either the sensation of the breath as it enters the nostrils, as it leaves the nostrils, and the sensation of your lips touching each other after the out-breath, before the next in-breath. Or the simple rising and falling of the abdomen and the feeling of the chair holding your body, the cushion holding your body. And you can go back and forth between the breath and the sounds and anything in between, physical sensations in the body, thoughts, feelings. But if you start to get lost, if you don't quite know what you're doing, use the breath as your central point of reference. attention wanders off of the breath, you have a choice. You can stay where the awareness goes and turn wherever it goes into another object of meditation, just being with it with bare attention, just feeling the texture of it. Or you can bring yourself back deliberately to the central object of the breath. It's up to you, and you can play with it yourself. Especially if you feel any kind of impatience or frustration or even questions in the mind, how long is this going to go on for, when is this going to stop, etc. Use the breath. When that kind of, we call it a hindrance or an obstacle, when that kind of material starts to come into the mind, really use the breath. Find the in-breath, find the out-breath, and then feel the lips touching. Really, really make the effort then. And the irritation, the frustration, it'll keep pulling you away perhaps, but bring yourself back to the breath if that's happening. Mess with my hearing.
Oh, sorry.
Just wait. Okay. Any questions about that? I'm trying to make it not so dogmatic that you have to do it this way or that way, but that you get a sense of the entire range of this is a little tiny version of the entire range, but so that you have a sense of the playful aspect of it, and that everyone has to sort of find their own way with it and tune themselves, you know, as they need it day by day. But it's very hard, but it's not that hard, right? Like sitting and doing nothing, but not just getting lost. Okay. So I want to read you my favorite, not the whole thing, but little bits of my favorite paper of Winnicott's, which is called Hate and the Countertransference. Countertransference is the official psychoanalytic language for what's going on in the therapist. Transference is when the patient either loves you or hates you or finds you to be a pain. But really, you're not doing anything. They're just projecting, you know, their parents or their children or their lovers or whatever on you. And therapists like to pretend that they're not really doing anything and that it's all coming from the patient, so they call it transference. But there's a big movement now within the therapy world to take responsibility for who you actually are and how you affect the patient and not to blame it all just on transference. But countertransference was a notion that developed to ask therapists to actually pay attention to what's going on inside of them in a meditative way while they're engaging in the therapy so that they can be aware of whatever they're bringing to the relationship. You know, some way that the patient reminds them of someone from their life so that the awareness of the countertransference is to help the therapist not act out in some destructive way on the patients, okay? So these discussions have gone on within the field of psychoanalysis for many years. This paper was written in 1947. But I think it relates a lot to what some people discover in the meditation itself, as I was talking about yesterday, because this weird thing happens in the meditation where we're making what in psychoanalysis is called a therapeutic split in the ego, you know, where we're both the observer and that which is being observed. And there's some kind of duality in that, to go back to our discussion from last night. You know, at first it really seems confusing, but it really seems like, oh yeah, there's the observer, the spy consciousness, you know, the bare attention, the person that aspect of us who's watching or feeling that's in the awareness, and then the aspect of us that's like all the stuff that we're carrying, all the burden, you know, that we're watching when we're watching our minds or when we're observing our bodies. So the attitude, it's like the mental posture, the mental equivalent of the sitting with the back straight and so on, the mental posture that we adopt in how we observe, it, I think, is very important. And when people who are meditating, like therapists, have a deep unconscious issue, for instance, with anger, with their own anger, or with anger that has been laid on them when they were children growing up, trying to soothe themselves with their transitional object, et cetera. If you have an issue with anger or with any other emotion, but I'm going to focus on hate or rage for the moment, if you have an issue with that, that's going to be affecting your meditation. You know, should irritation erupt, it's going to affect you in a different way than if you're cool with it. But part of the practice of the meditation, and the reason why that quality of bare attention is so important, is that you get to simultaneously feel your own attachment to your notions of what's right and wrong about anger. You get to simultaneously feel that and observe it, so you develop a lot more equanimity over time around whatever pre-existing attitudes you have about things, or around what was done, how what was done to you affects you unconsciously. it starts to emerge and you start to make peace with it. So you develop a different kind of relationship with yourself around it. So that's what Winnicott is talking about here. He's giving advice to other therapists and also to his patients. And really, I think, as all of us who write, he's giving advice to himself. So let me just read you bits and pieces of it, and I think you'll see why it's relevant. So from the beginning, a little bit in, what we as analysts call the countertransference needs to be understood by the psychiatrist too. However much he loves his patients, he cannot avoid hating them and fearing them. And the better he knows this, the less will hate and fear be the motives determining what he does to his patients. If the analyst is going to have crude feelings imputed to him, he is best forewarned and so forearmed, for he must tolerate being placed in that position. Above all, he must not deny hate that really exists in himself. Hate that is justified in the present setting has to be sorted out and kept in storage and available for eventual interpretation. Are there not many situations in our ordinary analytic work in which the analyst's hate is justified? A patient of mine, a very bad obsessional, was almost loathsome to me for some years. I felt bad about this until the analysis turned a corner and the patient became lovable. And then I realized that his unlikableness had been an active symptom, unconsciously determined. It was indeed a wonderful day for me, much later on, when I could actually tell the patient that I and his friends had felt repelled by him, but that he had been too ill for us to let him know. This was also an important day for him, a tremendous advance in his adjustment to reality. In the ordinary analysis, the analyst has no difficulty with the management of his own hate. The hate remains latent. The main thing, of course, is that through his own analysis, he has become free from vast reservoirs of unconscious hate belonging to the past and to inner conflicts. The analyst must be prepared to bear strain without expecting the patient to know anything about what he is doing, perhaps over a long period of time. To do this, he must be easily aware of his own fear and hate. I like that phrase, easily aware of his own fear and hate, because that's something I think that we're cultivating in our own way here. He is in the position of the mother of an infant, unborn or newly born. Eventually, he ought to be able to tell his patient what he has been through on the patient's behalf, but an analysis may never get as far as this. There may be too little good experience in the patient's past to work on. What if there be no satisfactory relationship of early infancy for the analyst to exploit in the transference? Out of all the complexity of the problem of hate and its roots, I want to rescue one thing, because I believe it has an importance for the analyst of patients. I suggest that the mother hates the baby before the baby hates the mother, and before the baby can know his mother hates him. However early integration may be achieved, there is a theoretical earlier stage in which whatever the infant does that hurts is not done in hate. I have used the term ruthless love in describing this stage. Is this acceptable? As the infant becomes able to feel to be a whole person, so does the word hate develop meaning as a description of a certain group of his feelings. So this is important, it might not be so clear. He's saying that in a really young infant, before the mind is capable of language or of identifying an emotion, there's still this raw energy that's directed at the mother, which he calls ruthless love, and that's an attack. The mother knows instinctively how to manage it, but sometimes it will evoke feelings of hate. That's why he's saying the mother hates the baby before, even in utero, the mother might be hating the baby because it's such an invasion of her body. So it's not necessarily the overriding emotion, but it can be there. And one of the things that Winnicott is great about is like trusting the mother's full emotional experience. So she's sort of naturally able to metabolize those feelings in the spirit of the overriding love that's there. But that doesn't mean that hate isn't there. So he goes on. The mother, however, hates her infant from the word go. I believe Freud thought it possible that a mother may, in certain circumstances, have only love for her baby boy, but we doubt this. We know about a mother's love, and we appreciate its reality and power. Let me give some of the reasons why a mother hates her baby, even a boy. And then he lists a bunch of reasons that I'll read to you, which are my favorite ones. The baby is not her own mental conception. That's the first reason. Okay. So it's a real thing, right? It's not the imagined baby that she was going to have from when she was a little girl, you know. It's not her own mental conception. It's its own thing. The baby is not the one of childhood play, father's child, brother's child, etc. The baby is not magically produced. The baby is a danger to her body in pregnancy and at birth. The baby is an interference with her private life, a challenge to preoccupation. Preoccupation is a good word for us, because self-preoccupation is, you know, at the base of what the Buddha is teaching us to overcome. To a greater or lesser extent, a mother feels that her own mother demands a baby so that her baby is produced to placate her mother. Yes. To a greater or lesser extent, a mother feels that her own mother demands a baby so that her baby is produced to placate her mother. So that's a reason to hate the baby. The baby hurts her nipples even by suckling, which is at first a chewing activity. He is ruthless, treats her as scum, an unpaid servant, a slave. She has to love him, excretions and all, at any rate at the beginning, till he has doubts about himself. He tries to hurt her, periodically bites her, all in love. He shows disillusionment about her. His excited love is cupboard love, so that having got what he wants, he throws her away like orange peel.
How does all of us have a chance?
Well, that's what he's getting. But the beautiful thing about this piece is that it's actually a testimonial to a mother's love. And that's, I think, why it's relevant for us in terms of what we're doing Buddha-wise with our minds, that the way to get there is to acknowledge the darkness, not to try to repress it. But I love that British phrase of cupboard love. And he throws her away like orange peel. Excuse me. The baby at first must dominate. He must be protected from coincidences. Life must unfold at the baby's rate. And all this needs his mother's continuous and detailed study. For instance, she must not be anxious when holding him, etc. And again, if you can apply this, it's interesting to apply this all to meditation. So if instead of, you know, like in Zen, the ox herding pictures, where it's like the guy goes out to try to tame the ox, and at first the ox can't find the ox, and then he sees the ox's horn, and then he rides on the ox and tames the ox, and then the ox and he disappear totally. In a way, this is like another version of that, because if the baby is your mind, you know, the baby at first must dominate, he must be protected from coincidences, life must unfold at the baby's rate, and all this needs his mother's continuous and detailed study, an interesting word. For instance, she must not be anxious when holding him, etc. At first, he does not know at all what she does or what she sacrifices for him. Especially, he cannot allow for her hate. He is suspicious, refuses her good food, and makes her doubt herself, but eats well with his aunt. After an awful morning with him, she goes out and he smiles at a stranger who says, "Isn't he sweet?" If she fails him at the start, she knows he will pay her out forever. He excites her, but frustrates. She mustn't eat him or trade in sex with him. That's another reason to hate him. I think that in the ultimate stages of the analysis, even of a normal person, the analyst must find himself in a position comparable to that of a mother of a newborn baby. When deeply repressed, the patient cannot identify with the analyst or appreciate his point of view any more than the fetus or newly born infant can sympathize with the mother. A mother has to be able to tolerate hating her baby without doing anything about it. She cannot express it to him. If for fear of what she may do, she cannot hate appropriately when hurt by her child, she must fall back on masochism. And I think it is this that gives rise to the false theory of a natural masochism in women. The most remarkable thing about a mother is her ability to be hurt so much by her baby and to hate so much without paying the child out, and her ability to wait for rewards that may or may not come at a later date. Perhaps she is helped by some of the nursery rhymes she sings, which her baby enjoys, but fortunately does not understand. Then he quotes one. Rock-a-bye baby on the treetop. When the wind blows, the cradle will rock. When the bough breaks, the cradle will fall. Down will come baby, cradle and all. I think of a mother or father, he says in parentheses, playing with a small infant, the infant enjoying the play and not knowing that the parent is expressing hate in the words, perhaps in terms of birth symbolism. This is not a sentimental rhyme. Sentimentality is useless for parents, as it contains a denial of hate, and sentimentality in a mother is no good at all from the infant's point of view. It seems to me doubtful whether a human child, as he develops, is capable of tolerating the full extent of his own hate in a sentimental environment. He needs hate to hate. That's why we try not to make Menla too sentimental an environment. Bob is very good at cutting through the sentimentality. An analyst has to display all the patience and tolerance and reliability of a mother devoted to her infant, has to recognize the patient's wishes as needs, has to put aside other interests in order to be available and to be punctual and objective, and has to seem to want to give what is really only given because of the patient's needs. There may be a long initial period in which the analyst's point of view cannot be appreciated, even unconsciously, by the patient. Acknowledgement cannot be expected because at the primitive root of the patient that is being looked for, there is no capacity for identification with the analyst, and certainly the patient cannot see that the analyst's hate is often engendered by the very things the patient does in his crude way of loving. So,
intense. The only thing,
yeah,
he said the baby is a danger to the mother's body, but
yeah,
he didn't say the tremendous pain experiences in childbirth.
That's right. That's right.
Somehow, as a man,
somehow,
he doesn't mention that.
He's not, that's right. And he's a pediatrician also, but he's...
A what?
He's also a pediatrician.
Oh, he was, but he was an obstetrician. Clearly.
That's right.
Mark,
so,
what was the title of that paper?
It's called Hate and the Countertransference.
What's the name again? Sorry.
Hate in the Countertransference. By Winnicott, 1947.
So brilliant. That's why when people say a Buddha is a being who considers every single being like a mother, her only beloved child,
mm-hmm,
they all get all sentimental about,
mm-hmm,
that.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel, poor guy. What a, you know,
what a
burden. What kind of a constitution must you have as a one person to stand such an attitude?
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
And that's so great.
Yeah.
Wow.
So you see the relevance for what we're doing. Yeah.
I see its relevance, and I'm just stunned at how little space there is in our culture to talk about that.
Yeah.
You know, like, I can't remember the last time I've had any discussion with anyone about mothers and hatred of their children.
Yes.
In a safe way.
In a safe way. Yeah, I'm afraid that's true. There's some literature about, people are writing about it a little bit, because Winnicott actually has, in a sort of quiet way, his writings have infiltrated a lot of, like there was a play on Broadway called Fun Home that I think just closed, that's from a graphic novel by Alison Bechtel about her growing up with a depressed gay father in the closet who kills himself. But Winnicott is all runs through that. She was very influenced by Winnicott, and there's a There's a book that's very popular in the art world these days called The Argonauts by a woman named Maggie Nelson. A wonderful little book. Have you seen this book yet? You
would Which love one?
It. It's called The Argonauts by Maggie Nelson.
No.
She teaches at Cal Arts.
Argonauts by Maggie Nelson.
Yeah, yeah. And she has, she's a heterosexual woman, but she's in a relationship with a woman who became a man, a trans man. But they have a baby together, and she writes about having a baby, and she's got Winnicott running all through it. It's definitely a kind of undercurrent. But it's nice to be able, I think this kind of discussion could happen in the Dharma centers. I think that, because I do think that we are, as we've been talking about, one of the things we're doing, not the only thing, but one of the things we're doing is trying to make the unconscious conscious. Using the meditative awareness that is available to us, that's latent in all of us, and we can tolerate, like Winnicott's talking about, being able to tolerate those primitive emotions. We can do that for ourselves, and it's important, especially in talking about addiction and anxiety and whatnot. You know?
So there's a book that is called The Monster Within.
Uh-huh.
That is also dealing exactly with these aspects, and it's very fascinating. It helped me a lot when I was a new mother.
Nice.
It was very, very liberating in this sense to acknowledge these feelings. So.
Yeah. Oh, she said there's a book called The Monster Within that has helped her a lot. There's this book that I carry around of Winnicott's that's just called Babies and Their Mothers. This is it's a compilation of talks that he gave to, like radio talks, and talks that he gave to the La Leche, league to promote breastfeeding and so on. Not his professional papers, but it's a beautiful, beautiful. If we have time, I'll read a couple little bits from it too. But it has helped me a lot in my writing.
It's just, I'd like to share one thing.
Yes,
coming to you from listening to that. Actually, in Buddhist psychology, hate is related to intelligence,
mm-hmm.
because hate also takes something apart and destroys it. And understanding something, the analysis means taking something apart.
Mm-hmm.
And the wish to attain a state apart from the world is a kind of willingness to destroy the entire world. So withdrawal from it is like, forget it, it doesn't exist, I'm going to nirvana type of thing. So then, if in connection to addiction, if you see the construction by the relative being, which from Buddhist psychology point of view comes also from previous animal life, unenlightened animal life, it isn't just made up by a baby, but there's sort of a rehearsal of it, I guess, in the formation of the character of a baby. But if you see that, then the creation of a space that is disconnected from everything, to escape from, becomes like a root of addiction. Like heroin, for example, like makes you unconscious of what's around you, and it seems to accelerate an ability, without knowing how to meditate,
mm-hmm.
to withdraw from the connection to everything,
mm-hmm.
right? So this thing about, so then enlightenment, with the double consciousness of enlightenment, where you see through all beings, and everything is just bliss, but they're still there like transparent glass objects somehow. Somehow, instead of hating them all, the pain, the danger to you is no longer there because you see through everything. And then on another level, you also can empathize. You're capable of loving and empathizing it, because in a way, you don't feel you need to, you know you can't withdraw, and also you don't feel you need to, because you found that imagined bliss actually is the reality of the relativity,
mm-hmm.
something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So the ability to love in spite of hate, or at simultaneously almost,
mm-hmm.
and be without denial, expanded to an inconceivable degree, of course, might somehow relate to enlightenment. And the difficulty of stopping addiction and suicide sort of type of thing, when someone feels justified that there is this place apart from everything, they can destroy the whole world in a vast rage, which will destroy their body, because the body has become other than them. because they assume there's a place they will really be safe from it all, you know, which is that inner psychotic seed of the false self sense, right? Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I don't know what that all means. But it just, I don't, but it's just, there's something really interesting about it. That's all I'm saying from in this space that you're creating.
Well, what you're saying is making me think about this thing that I brought about sexual love, an old teacher of mine named Otto Kernberg, who's a famous psychoanalyst and ran the psychiatric hospital that I trained at, wrote, but he loved to write about adult love. And he wrote this beautiful thing, this is the best thing I ever found about sexual relations, because that sexual relations is used in Buddhism a lot as a metaphor for, I think, mm-hmm. what you're talking about, which is the interdependence of love and even love and hate, mm-hmm. The taking of the need to, the desire to take apart the loved object and also mm-hmm. to intermingle with them. So he wrote that, let me just read you this thing, because it always moves me. The language is a little bit difficult, so stop me if you need to. There is an intrinsic contradiction in the combination of two crucial features of sexual love: the constant awareness of the indissoluble separateness of individuals on the one hand, and the sense of transcendence, of becoming one with the loved person, on the other. Mm-hmm. The separateness results in loneliness and longing and fear for the frailty of all relations. Transcendence in the couple's union brings about the sense of oneness with the world, of permanence and new creation. Loneliness, we might say, is a prerequisite for transcendence. To remain within the boundaries of the self while transcending them in identification with the loved object is an exciting, moving, and yet painful condition of love. The Mexican poet Octavio Paz has expressed this aspect of love with an almost overwhelming conciseness, stating that love is the point of intersection between desire and reality. Love, he says, reveals reality to desire and creates the transition from the erotic object to the beloved person. This revelation is almost always painful because the beloved presents himself or herself simultaneously as a body which can be penetrated and a consciousness which is impenetrable. Mm-hmm. Love is the revelation of the other person's freedom. The contradictory nature of love is that desire aspires to be fulfilled by the destruction of the desired object, and love discovers that this object is indestructible and cannot be substituted.
Can you read that again? The last part.
The last part? Love is the revelation of the other person's freedom. The contradictory nature of love is that desire aspires to be fulfilled by the destruction of the desired object. That's the Winnicottian ruthless love. Like you can never get enough of the other. So then that's also the hate that mm-hmm. wants to take apart. You can never. That's the ruthlessness. You can never get enough. That's the sense even in a highly charged erotic lovemaking, that of the desire to, devour the other, basically. So desire aspires to be fulfilled by the destruction of the desired object, and love discovers that this object is indestructible and cannot be substituted. And that's the impenetrability of the other's consciousness, which we might debate that the consciousness is. Mm-hmm. But we do all have our own unique consciousnesses, even if we're united by that membrane of shunyata. Mm-hmm. What do you think?
So, it's like there's a sort of combination of cherishing and destroying.
Yeah.
But then it's so interesting that reality itself is so kind.
Yeah.
Because even in the most destructive sort of thing at the boundary of life and death, right? Like the French expression for powerful orgasm, right? It's the little death. Zen description of enlightenment is the great death. And so in this sort of thing, then the self is destroyed, actually, melts it together. And then there's a kind of openness to life. It comes back out of this complete flinging oneself away and even taking the loved one with you, it's the idea. So from both sides, it's really interesting. therefore sexual, you know, in the Buddhist ethics, to use sexuality abusively in harming that object in other ways. In other words, totally harming it in some way, rather than just sort of the subconscious melting into it sort of harm, is like considered the worst thing, because that human moment is a time when sort of reality reveals itself as nurturing, even to the hostile and the aggressive and the greedy, you know. It reveals itself as replenishing, something like that. So to evade that moment with the egocentric, you know, greedy, destructive thing is then the most self-defeating thing you can possibly do, besides harming to the other, something like that. Again, I'm not saying I understand all that.
Yeah, well, that makes sense.
But this is a great, that guy, you know, Winnicott is like.
But who was that?
Yeah. Winnicott.
That was Kernberg.
Winnicott.
What's the name again?
Otto Kernberg. It's from a book called Love Relations.
Do you think that the last paragraph could also apply to addiction, right? It's Definitely. The object that I love and I can't destroy, right? I can never overcome that object. Right, and that object is never going to love me back.
Yes.
And that's why it's so destructive. Like, you know, with relations, it's one thing, because I love and cherish the object that I'm, you know, involved with, and it, you know, I desire it, and it loves me back.
Yes.
But my addiction can't love me back.
That's right. That's exactly right. And so, the great revelation that Kernberg's getting to, that does come from Winnicott, is the discovery of the beloved, whether it's the mother or the lover, the discovery of the beloved's otherness, you know, which is the cherishing aspect. And I think a lot of times in addiction, there's the search for the personal obliteration that comes in love, but you don't get, like you're saying, you don't get the other side of it, which is like, oh, they're like we need these other people. If we're trying to make ourselves into a self-sufficient isolate, you know, with the help of the substance or even in meditation, where that it's not going to work. We have to have this cherishing relationship to other people. We need that. We've needed that since we were little kids, and we still need that. Yeah, I think you're on to something important there.
So the interesting thing then is that the inconceivability of non-dualism,
yeah,
where to avoid thinking when you say emptiness is relativity, you know, emptiness the womb of compassion, to avoid the idea that this collapses to materialist resignation that all there is relativity. So we're just here stuck in relativity, we resign. Like enlightenment is the ultimate resignation, which I'm afraid is how most people think about it, even who teach it. They think, you know, the way Zen is misinterpreted.
Mm-hmm.
First you draw water and cut wood, then you something, it all disappears, then again you're drawing water and cutting wood. So the American response, that is hell, just draw water and cut wood, make bread, forget about it. Then you're enlightened, which is total BS, because you couldn't stand that in an expanded state if you didn't have a complete separation, you didn't achieve the psychosis, actually. So Buddhahood is a kind of smearing of the psychosis over the entire infinity, and then not seeing anybody else ever anywhere, and then in that melted state, restoring like affection individually, like in a play or a film, when you identify with the hero or heroine, and you freak out when something happens to them, but in a way you still know that it's a play. I mean, some intuition of yours, so you're not completely going berserk, but you can go berserk in a good drama where you really get involved with it. You really identify with the people in the action. But on the other hand, you know it's unreal. Mm-hmm. So there you'd see through it simultaneously, and you're capable of full aesthetic identification with it because you know it's unreal, something like that, simultaneously. Mm-hmm. So you're not in denial that there is this defense mechanism of creating a separated self. So you're both a separated self and completely identified with everything, something like that. That's why what I said just now doesn't reach it, because it's inconceivable.
Mm.
Right? Mm. That's inconceivable. Mm. How can you hate and love at the same time?
Mm-hmm.
Really, both.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Interesting. Mm. Right. Again, is it?
This is a complex question, but could you address a little bit about those people, those patients, clients we work with, for whom what you're describing is not in the cards for them? That kind of mutual sexual love, where you have the obliteration of self, the integration of love and hate, destructive, constructive.
Mm-hmm.
And clearly addiction is not the solution,
mm-hmm.
but many, many people do not have for themselves what you were describing.
Right.
And yet it's important to have a livable, rich life without that. And what I've intimated in your thinking is that, well, through meditation and Buddhism, there can be a letting go of that desire for what was never experienced in the early relationships and is not in the cards for a lot of people in their adult relationships.
Mm-hmm. Could you all hear?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Well, not just meditation and Buddhism, but also therapy. So remember the thing that I read yesterday from Winnicott about psychotherapy is two people playing together, but when one person's not able to play, then the therapy is about bringing them from a state of not being able to play into a state of being able to play. So I think like what Kernberg's talking about is on the physical level, okay, between two people who love each other and have a good sexual relationship, etc., then that becomes a kind of meditation. Their sexual relationship itself becomes a kind of meditation because it's ever deepening and widening, and these kinds of experiences are possible within it, and they are instructive because they make us question the nature of the self and the nature of the other, and etc. So I think the reason that when you look deeply at some aspects of Buddhism, that they're using sexual metaphors to describe the deepest experiences that are possible. It's because you can experience all of this in other kinds of relationships. So I think even in therapy, which I believe in and have spent a lot of my life doing, that the member Winnicott was talking about the play. Even in adults, comes in the form of humor, comes in the form, in the kind of language that's used. So even for patients who seem to be stuck and don't have nurturing relationships and are coming off of substance issues and so on, the relationship that's developed with the therapist or in a 12-step community or with whomever, those relationships contain the essence of all the stuff that we're talking about. And the more real they get, you know, because we're moving towards the real always. We're coming with our defenses, and, you know, therapy is a sort of magical thing that it exists in our culture where, you know, you can go into a room with another person and have no agenda and see what happens, you know, and not get into an abusive situation because there's an ethical kind of protection that an unfolding of this kind can occur. And then you'd be surprised why, you know, people find relationships with them because we're social animals. And I've worked with a lot of people who despaired for years and years. They're never going to find a relationship. And then all it takes is a moment.
Yes. Small question.
Yeah.
Okay, it's about love. It could be with a child and a parent, or with like a spouse, a husband and a wife. This thing about love, like, I don't get it, you know? Like, is it love because you have to like be one? Like, I'm not okay with that. Like, I don't want to merge with somebody else, you know? And I believe in love deeply, I do. And that's what it feels like, you know? Like, I don't know, to me. So if I want something from me. I don't know, maybe that's just a
self-protective,
but just curious, is that the ultimate love? Well, like in Buddhist terms?
No, it's a good question. No, the ultimate love is not a merger. That's a fantasy that merger is possible. That's what when I was talking yesterday about my own, or a sustained merger. When I was talking yesterday about my own struggles early in my marriage, you know, it's because I was looking for that, you know, because I didn't want to be myself. I just wanted to be, you know, something else. But the discovery is more along the lines of what Kernberg's talking about, the simultaneity of self and other, so that you're you know, coming in and out of a togetherness and a separateness. And, you know, I wrote
that's enlightened love, but
yeah.
But love is defined in Buddhist psychology as purely the wish for the happiness of the object.
The wish
purely
for the
happiness. Happiness of the beloved. No yeah. sense of desire to grasp or to
yeah.
contain it oneself. And so in the human sexuality, because of the high sensitivity and the self-reflexiveness of the human being, the evolved human being, the wish to give oneself to the other, therefore to give all of one's energy to the other in some sense, that it, if that makes the other happy, or one has the fantasy that it does, is based on the realization of selflessness completely. So, if you know, but it involves like being willing to die, actually. And then the mother biologically thinks, in spite of the irritations that Winnicott so beautifully describes, minus the pain thing, the idea that the mother, in spite of all of that, is willing in mammal forms to die for the young. That is to give every sort of sense of seizure or connection to reality or even her awareness away to the beloved is therefore the model of selfless love. And that would be called the ultimate love, at least in Buddhist psychology.
Yeah.
But that's
different from the merger that you are afraid of. Like the
possession.
Well, she's not.
Feels like.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you don't want to have a future life either. You're afraid of that too.
Well,
you're like,
but
actually, you're totally fearless. In fact, but you're going. I'm afraid of everything. That's your thing.
Then I'll be good with.
What?
If I be like Buddha's right hand guy, okay, I'll be good with. Because
I'm the wolf. Totally fearless. Okay, forward.
But,
yeah, but you always say that. But on the other hand, you know, once you totally give yourself up, if something merges, you don't even pay any attention to it. You're beyond that. And it's really the giving of the self up that releases the pleasure, you know, releases the relief. That's the release. What are they doing with heroin, those stupid people jabbing themselves in the arm? They're trying to get out of themselves. That's what they're looking for. That's what's addictive. But they're doing such things that they don't really fully do it. You know, if you could inject yourself with St. Buddha, that would be fine. Make up a drug like that, Mr. Hoffman LaRoche, or whatever they are, you know, Prozac, like just inject yourself and be a Buddha, but that doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way, unfortunately, because they keep coming back.
Maybe they can find the gene.
It's like all those. Right?
Maybe they can find the gene.
Yeah, that's right. They're always trying to find the gene, and this is that exact
Buddha gene.
Meanwhile, the Buddha gene is there.
Yeah.
But you can't find
that. That would be a good
in a lab. You can't find it in a lab. You can't find it by hacking people's breasts off.
That would be
you
good.
Don't
start
it.
With that again.
by internally finding your own spiritual gene. Gene, by the way.
Yes.
Gene comes from Latin gens, which means tribe. And is again this egotistical thing of projecting the ego into the tribe and the blood and the whole thing. And you know, when you tell someone your gene is your problem, you're blaming their tribe. You're going after them as a material entity, and you're saying it's not our problem of not understanding your condition and what the epigenetic gene expression controls and causes that, and our alliance and hand in hand making money with Monsanto and poisoning the soil and destroying the food with General Mills. We're not to blame. You're to blame. Your family's to blame. And of course, the other great thing, blame the parents.
That's right. We're in that business. We're trying to get out of
it. Anyway, never mind. Let's not get into that.
Okay.
I didn't mean to get into that.
Okay. I want to present one more thing, and then I'm going to turn the stage over.
No. Yeah, but I'm doing something very peaceful.
I know.
I'm doing the mother.
So I want to come back to the. There'll be time.
Okay.
I want to come back to the hate and the counter transference and so on, but looking at it from a different point of view. So there's a well-known poet named Louise Gluck. Any of you familiar with her work?
Yes.
Who? Louise Gluck.
Oh.
So this is a portrait that was in the New Yorker a while ago about her that I think you'll see the relevance when we get into it. She was born in 1943 in New York City and raised on Long Island. A sister died before Gluck was born. Her death was not my experience, but her absence was, Gluck writes in an essay. Her death let me be born. That severity of judgment is typical of her. She often pares experience down to brutal cause and effect. Gluck sought her mother's approval exclusively, approval that was usually withheld. Her father, who had helped bring the X-Acto knife to market, was a worldly success with buried literary ambitions. A younger sister appears in Gluck's poems, sometimes as ally, often as rival. Much of life for Gluck is livable only when hostile factions lay aside their arms. It is a view of social life as driven not by altruism, but by truce, and it was formed in that home. Speaking of hate and the criticalness of hate, that is also wisdom. When she was 16, Gluck, suffering from anorexia, nearly starved herself to death. Her formal schooling was sporadic from that moment forward. See, I think this is relevant because the Buddha, we have to remember, had his years in the forest where he also nearly starved himself to death. Mm-hmm. Practicing all, you know, ascetic practices were thought to be a way to critical wisdom. And that's, I think, underlying a lot, some of the anorexia that is in our society. Certainly was for her.
Out of himself.
Yes, exactly. Or out of the situation. Her formal schooling was sporadic from that moment forward, from when she was 16 and became anorectic. She spent 7 years in psychoanalysis and eventually apprenticed herself to two poets, first Leonie Adams, then Stanley Kunitz, both of whom she met during a brief period at Columbia. Anorexia seems to have been a clumsy early form of writing poetry, focusing exclusively and therefore tragically on form. Analysis, which replaced anorexia by describing it, would then be an improvement, except that it had no form. Its truths were inert and abstract. Only in poetry could the formal manifestations of insight be explored, a fact that she explores in form in a section of a piece called Dedication to Hunger, called Descending Figure. And then this is the poem. It begins quietly, in certain female children, the fear of death, taking as its form dedication to hunger. Because a woman's body is a grave, it will accept anything. I remember lying in bed at night, touching the soft, digressive breasts, touching at 15 the interfering flesh that I would sacrifice until the limbs were free of blossom and subterfuge. I felt what I feel now, aligning these words. It is the same need to perfect, of which death is the mere byproduct. Mm. Blossom, this is the writer of the article, blossom is what grown-ups say little girls' bodies do. To the girls, it feels more like subterfuge. That pair of words reveals so much about what drove Gluck in poems like this one. The need to perfect, certainly. But what poet doesn't feel some version of that need? Gluck's provocative difference was to link perfection with forms of defiance. As she writes in another poem called The Education of the Poet, by the time I was 16, a number of things were clear to me. It was clear that what I had thought of as an act of will, an act I was perfectly capable of controlling, of terminating, was not that. I realized that I had no control over this behavior at all. And I realized, logically, that to be 85, then 80, then 75 pounds was to be thin. I understood that at some point I was going to die. Even then, dying seemed like a pathetic metaphor for establishing a separation between myself and my mother. It's a nice article. I'll just read you from the end, then. There's plenty to be sad about in Gluck's recent work. We expect her to be adept at delivering bad news. But all that severity is paying some tremendous dividends now in a poet who has been on record about misery all along. These new poems are funny, abundantly social, and often, where we expect a bitter judgment, merciful. Here she is in Fugue, a poem from Averno, remembering a child's game of family. I was the man because I was taller. My sister decided when we should eat. From time to time, she'd have a baby. Later in the same poem, she retells a dream. I had a dream. My mother fell out of a tree. After she fell, the tree died. It had outlived its function. And in Crossroads, one of many sublime lyrics in A Village Life, after a lifetime of combating her body, she makes the most unlikely truce of all. My body, now that we will not be traveling together much longer, I begin to feel a new tenderness toward you, very raw and unfamiliar, like what I remember of love when I was young. This is a boast. Wherever the body ends up, this voice is not going to go away. So she makes some kind of transformation.
She died, you say?
No, she's still alive. Oh, she's writing beautiful things. Like this, the nurturing, you know, the compassionate element of the universe, you know, has infiltrated. She's took her suffering apart, you know, through poetry. And something emerged.
The New Yorker is the Buddha Dharma.
It is, for me it is.
You're the only one who finds it there.
Yeah, that's true. Not the only one.
He has every old New Yorker and every like amazing thing. Incredible.
Sometimes I bring the obituaries. And okay, so that's...
It's this amazing space.
Yeah.
It is amazing space, healing space.
And I think she's using poetry like we're trying to use meditation, you know, which is to give, to put some kind of language, some kind of form on an inchoate experience that we're carrying around, you know, that is pushing us, you know, unconsciously making us do things we don't necessarily want to do. But if we create a big enough field in which to observe it in, then we can identify it, put language on it even, and hold the experience in a way that gives us that much more control. And that allows this other energy, you know, which is the latent, what we're calling mother energy, to infiltrate. Did you have a question?
Love and sex addiction.
Well, the love and sex addiction, I think, is more is where the erotic object and not the beloved person. The erotic object is taking precedence over the beloved person. Mm-hmm. So the experience of sexual stimulation and momentary obliteration is being sought time and time again in an addictive way. But it can't be sustained. So you're in this addictive loop. So that I think is pretty clear. The codependent thing, I think, has to do with not valuing one's own experience enough. Not letting oneself matter enough, not feeling like one matters enough, so that there's a sense of wanting to lose oneself in the other, in the more troubled person's troubles. You know, there's a sense of both losing oneself and ennobling oneself by giving oneself totally to someone who is going to destroy you. Or to someone who, at the very least, doesn't value you as a beloved person, but is instead just sucking, you know, all of your good energy. And I think underlying that is some sense of a deficiency, or at least a wish to self-obliterate because of a feeling of worthlessness or unworthiness or whatever. But I think a lot of people's early relationships, you know, first marriages and so on, a certain kind of person, a lot of people's early intimate relationships can take that form because you have this vision of what it is to be in a relationship, which is to give and give and give. and you find a person who is, you know, is troubled in a certain way, and you feel like you can heal them, and that, so there's a certain kind of narcissism locked in there also, a certain kind of wish for omnipotence that is the other side of the feeling not good enough about yourself. Does that make sense? Yeah,
I wonder if you can talk a little bit about safety. I've been thinking about that. I've heard it said before that one needs a sense of self in the psychological sense before one can give up the self in the Buddhist sense. And I've been thinking about that a little bit with transitional objects and kind of we need those sort of objects in order to let go in the sort of Buddhist sense of non-attachment and kind of how that relates to safety.
Well, the way I think of safety is in this notion of the holding environment that comes from Winnicott. So developmentally, the baby, the young child, gets the sense of safety from the parents who are able to be present but not too present. You know, not abandoning, not intrusive. The Winnicottian ideal is, you know, the mother in the next room, the baby, the child knows the mother is there. She's sewing or making dinner or whatever, watching TV or on her phone now. But the child knows that the mother is there if needed, but there's enough space so that the child is able to get lost in their imagination, in their play, etc. But if something goes wrong, they know that the parent is there. Too much, the distance is too great, then there's the sense, Winnicott talks about the sense of being infinitely dropped, or of going to pieces and falling apart. You know, the way my book title, Going to Pieces Without Falling Apart, is that's the Winnicottian ideal where, you know, you don't have to keep yourself together all the time while on the lookout for what something bad is gonna happen. There's safety in the overarching presence of the parents, but there's also space. So I think what we're recreating in meditation, at least at the beginning, is another version of that, where we're creating this holding environment, you know, which is the environment of meditation, in which we're making room for whatever comes up. You know, we're not abandoning when it gets too difficult, but we're not overly intrusive, you know, like fussing over, oh, there's a moment of hatred or there's a sexual fantasy, and, you know, we're not condemning. So there's a recreation of that kind of environment, which allows you to sort of stabilize in ways that you might not have when you were growing up. That's my notion. The sense that you have to be a self before you can lose the self, that was a notion of our friend Jack Englers, who I mentioned yesterday, which was very helpful in terms of the so-called borderline patient, borderline character, people who were drawn to meditation but didn't really have the ego strength to withstand the rigors of meditation. So he was sort of saying, like, a lot of people need therapy before they can really use meditation the way it's the way it can be best used. But
it is the first key, is finding the feeling that you have this real self.
That's right, and that's where you can't understand selflessness until you really come to terms with the self as you experience it. But the other thing to remember is that the self that we think we need before we can lose it was never real in the first place. So you can use meditation even when you're unsure of who yourself, you know, who you are. Those feelings of emptiness that are not Buddhist emptiness, what meditation encourages is that you just find it, you know, the way we say, listen to the sounds or the lack of sounds, or feel the sensation or the lack of sensation. You know, you find the self or the lack of self, however you experience yourself, even if it's as an empty void, you know, or as a worthless piece of whatever, you know, you zero in on that feeling. Whatever it is enough for the first key. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I think that, this idea of meditation as creating a safe space, but then also Buddhism says sort of there is nothing to rely on, right? There's no ground. There is no safe space in that sense.
Well, I think we're going to hear, like, I think that's a... an overly severe take on what Buddhism says.
Dharma means to be held, hold. Something that holds. That is the ground. That is the safety.
Holding nothing to hold on to, right?
Groundlessness is not nothing to hold. Groundlessness is the safe space and is the ground. It's a problem with words, but not with experience. So there's a wrong nihilistic idea that because Americans are already nihilistic, you understand? We already are so casual the way we live because we think that we're nothing. We grow up thinking that. That's what they tell you. That's what they tell you from Harvard, MIT. Really, you're nothing. So we think we're safe. So then we hear about the Dharma or emptiness, everything. Oh, no ground, nothing. And that doesn't feel very, that makes us feel nervous.
The not holding on is not clinging. But the sense of needing nothing to hold on to is that there's buoyancy, that you can float. And what are you floating in?
Yeah.
You're floating
in
this.
Nothing to hold. If we were nothing, it would be truly safe. We'd be cool. We are already in nirvana. We just temporarily wouldn't experience it because the brain is fooling us to think we're not. Just blow it out and we're in nirvana. That's the American way. That's why there's no priority for people to actually become enlightened, to find some kind of a thing, because they don't believe there is such a thing. It's just accepting that you're nothing. Because materialism has discovered reality, don't you know? Harvard, MIT, Columbia, they're based on that. They discovered it. All those religious people, they were all primitive, pre-modern, undeveloped. So we were recklessly running around, and even we don't care, because go for it. You know, that's our slogan. No?
The reason for stressing.
That's safe.
The reason for stressing all the mother stuff.
It's just that isn't there.
Is because the Buddha himself, when at the height of his anorexia, when he thought there really was nothing to hold on to, he was trying to get rid of everything. And he had, at that moment, he had a revelation. And the revelation came in the form of a childhood memory. And he remembered, being a young boy, sitting under a rose apple tree, his father plowing in the distance, in Winnicottian distance. And he was filled with a sense of joy, a sense of the beneficence of the universe kind of feeling. And it was that memory clicked something for him. And he thought to himself, oh my God, what if that is the right direction towards enlightenment, not this one that I'm going to, which is nothing to hold on to, et cetera.
Well, so nothing fixed and unchanging to hold on to, right?
No need to hold on to anything because we're in a safe space.
That's the Buddha's news. We're not nothing. We're not nothing, and we're in a safe place. Reality is a safe place. That's a huge difference between...
What is safe about reality? What is safe about reality?
What is safe?
Yeah.
Place here?
What is safe about reality?
Reality, it's clear light, infinite energy. It's that the void has infinite energy. It's like the mathematical, it's called, the quantum people have encountered it mathematically. They call it the zero quantum vacuum field or something like that. They have different terms like that, where mathematically the vacuum has infinite energy. Because it's infinite, it doesn't do anything. So it seems not to be active. But then it's infinitely sustaining. So it's totally safe. You can die. You can die happy if you know that. You know, it's so safe you can just die happily. You can do that. But the idea that you can be nothing, which is our version of the safe place, why we gravitated away from all those preachers and all those supposedly religious people who talked about hell and really dangerous types of being selfish, what happens when you're really selfish and isolated from everything. Try to, unrealistically. And we escape from that by just saying, oh, it's just nothing. Right? There's no soul. There's no mind. There's no consciousness, nothing. So then we think we can die happy because we'll be non-existent. And then we just, in this life here, where we're temporarily not nothing, we can just sort of get the best sensory experience that we can. And then, because then ultimately it ends in nothing. And those who are impatient shoot up on heroin and things and obliterate them, their consciousness in various ways, or they meditate and go into realms of nothingness in meditation, and they feel happy with that. And they think when they die their problems will be over, right? But according to their own law of thermodynamics, energy is never destroyed. It just changes form, right? But if one knows that there's an infinite plenum of energy to sustain whatever one wants to be and sustain one free of pain, then that is a safe place. Clear light of the void. I mean, that's what does nirvana mean? Do you really think nirvana just means it's just Buddha's preliminary prediction of what MIT, Daniel Dennett, these kind of people will tell you that, you know, your consciousness is an illusion and you're going to die and then you'll be nothing, so don't worry about it too much. You really think that's what Buddha discovered?
I'm not advocating for nothingness. I'm not advocating for nothingness.
Go.
Yeah, I'm just more curious about the idea of safety and how it plays a role in both therapy and spirituality and kind of going, like, I think that we need to experience safety to let go of the self. And I'm more curious about safety.
What do you do every night
trust.
When you fall asleep?
What do I do?
Yeah.
I close my eyes.
You go on, you let go of your conscious adjustment and monitoring of your environment.
Yeah.
You completely give yourself up. What anything could happen to you when you're asleep, you're unconscious, right? Intuitively, you don't fear to do that. You feel it's safe enough to do that, right? Usually.
Right, my teeth.
If you don't, if you don't fall asleep, I think if you don't fall asleep, you die in about 27 days. There's some kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like that. There's a disease. I know this French painter, Edith Vachon, his name, and he got into a thing where he couldn't fall asleep, and they had hospitals and ambulances at his atelier on Boulevard Arago, trying to like get him to sleep. He took pills, everything, couldn't sleep.
Michael Jackson.
And he was going to die.
Jackson.
What?
Michael Jackson, too.
Oh, yeah, he couldn't sleep?
That was his whole thing, yeah.
So in other words, yeah, because he got into it not safe.
Yeah.
So the thing about it, is the default thing, clear light of the void means, nirvana, third noble truth, means that ultimately the reality of things is all right. It's okay. The nothingness also simulates that. And if that were true, fine. But actually, there's no evidence for that. No one has experienced that and reported back that it was cool. I'm happy. I'm nothing. And nobody ever will, actually. There's no evidence for it at all. So it's hard to think, because we're so sensitive and so scared. And for thousands of years, we've been relying on the defense mechanism that there's something about us that is withdrawn from everything. And someone informed us. Many people informed us. Pythagoras, Socrates, Confucius, Buddha, and many other sages, that actually it's all right. You know, the default thing is all right. Even you die, you can die happy. And therefore the way of adapting to it's being all right is you try to help others be all right. And you don't like run away from the whole thing. But have we been listening? No, we haven't. We're still killing each other. We're still wrecking the planet.
The thing that helped me with this.
Because we're scared. We're still scared.
The thing that helped me with this question of safety is when hearing Bob talk about the real meaning of shunyata, you know, as not just a void, but as the pregnant void, you know, so that the underlying, if you think that as the underlying fabric of things, it's not a neutral energy, you know, it's not a scary energy. The underlying fabric of things has some kind of loving energy, you know, which is why I think all this mother-child stuff is relevant.
Right.
And so that's there in us. It's there in you, you know. And that you can rest in that. And that's where real safety comes from. And then it's expressed as this desire to help others, because once you're okay with it, then what else is, you know, what other use do you have but that? And that feels good.
Can you say that again?
There's an underlying when you poke through all the curtains of yourself, what you come to is this experience of emptiness or shunyata, which has an affective flavor or tone or feeling, right? Which is a loving feeling. So that people often who spend a lot of time in Buddhism and hear the teachings differently. You come up feeling like, oh, it's so dry and it's a little, so scary, nothing to hold on to, and with the, you know, not, that's why Bob's going on about the nothingness, because it's a misperception of what the ultimate reality is.
It's actually a useful misperception in a way, because it made people less scared of the high priest and the pope and the king and the strong man that caused so much trouble in history. You know? And so it's useful, mm-hmm. but then people get addicted to that.
Mm-hmm.
And then since it's not there, it's easy to, it's a blind faith thing that makes you able to live recklessly and destructively, which is the way our society and the world society now it's living. One thing that the Hindus and the Buddhists and the Jains and everybody agreed in ancient India was that the nihilism, you know, mental nihilism, let's not say spiritual, because that spiritual sounds woo to people, but mental nihilism, if people who adopt hold that view, either by theory or experience, from experiencing the medium of absolute nothingness, which is something you can experience, if they ever got in control of society and, you know, were the advisors to the kings or were the kings, it would be a disaster for everybody because they'd be utterly reckless. Because the idea is that you're out of causality when you're in your relational self, and therefore you can do anything you can get away with. And therefore, you're reckless, so you destroy everything, actually. And the thing about the safe place has to do also with key thing in our culture, which is what I wanted to start with, if I do that, which is that we despise ourselves. We are raised and we are brought up to despise ourselves. In America, we're told, I'm a great American. He's a great American. We're great Americans. We have guns. We're free. But actually, we're taught to despise ourselves because, what is that scientific thing? Is it, I never can remember if it's 15 cents of cheap chemicals in a bag of water or it's 85 cents of cheap chemicals. I can't remember. Maybe there's an inflation. But that's what the human being is. That's what we are. 85 cents of cheap chemicals in a bag of water that will melt that down, and then our mind will not be involved with that any longer, and we'll be fine, right? But basically, our life form is something contemptible, actually. And that, like, look at Ray Kurzweil. He has a big research center at Stanford. Everybody, you know, singularity, we're all coming there. You know? So we're all going to be, we're going to solve the fact that we're wrecking the planet by everybody's going to become an immortal robot. Hopefully only Republicans. But that's the level of despising of the soft, corruptible, rottable human body, which is, so therefore, first step in the Buddhist path is to critically, not to believe that you are a precious being. You are not only like a great human, you are really precious, even if you're not an American. You're totally precious because you have evolved yourself through spiritual struggle in all different life forms from beginningless time to become this amazing, very soft, sensitive, impermanent, aware, self-reflexive being that can be loving of everything. And therefore part of reality, part of the deepest nature of reality, which is infinite love. And you are that being. And you earned it yourself, not just your genes. Your genes, despite the bad one that the parent left you that makes you like unacceptable, whatever. You earned it yourself in previous life. That's why that biological view, it's not karma is not a mystical thing, it's a biological theory, which like all theories about relative reality, you know, somebody can supersede it. It's not an absolute dogma. But if you think about it, if you meditate, and the way you meditate on things in Buddhism, right now meditate. Meditate on yourself. You brought up to think that you are this fragile thing, you're susceptible to all kinds of germs and allergies, and you're really vulnerable, and you're going to starve yourself, or you're going to do this and that, and you're really no good. And even when there was a spirituality over here, these authorities in the society told you were no good, you're a sinner forever. And God made you, but he didn't really like it, you know, because, you know, so you have to go through a lot of torture to get to where you can really be one with them again or something like that. And then people fill in, oh, yeah, you can just find Jesus, you can get Buddha. Buddhists do the same. You can get Buddha, you can do something, and you'll be fine. But there's a great tendency in all of the authoritarian human societies on this planet to tell everybody they are no good. But actually, you are fantastic. And then you start to think about it. Meditate. Do you really think you're fantastic? Really? Yeah, you might be arrogant because you're middle class or you have a bank account or you have a job or you know something. You have an MA or PhD or you spent years in Zen or whatever. you have some kind of credential. But basically, all of that is to make up for your worthlessness. No free lunch. No free lunch. You don't deserve to eat if you don't work. You're worthless. And so stop to think, why are they telling me that? What is their evidence for that fact? Right? Well, somehow I'm part of this accident, and I'm a random mutation, and I'm meaningless and purposeless. Or before that, I'm a sinner, and I have to suffer. Later, I go with Dante and Beatrice, and I'll have a good time. But I'm singing the choir. I won't be God. I won't be God. No, no, no. God is the big daddy. I won't be that. But I'll be up there singing in the choir. So what would make you think you're really worthful? That you're at the evolutionary brink of a transformation. You're like a at the moment in the cocoon, where you could transform into this incredible being that would be nothing but a wish-fulfilling jewel for all other beings. You have that potential. And you have earned that yourself evolutionarily. Now, if that is an evidenced explanation, a reasonable explanation, not absolute, there's no absolute explanation of the inconceivable world, but a better one than the one that you're a worthless, useless thing, temporarily not being the real nothing that you are, right? Which has no evidence at all. It's a pure dogmatic assertion. There's no evidence that anything can ever be nothing. In fact, it's an insane use of language to say something is nothing. Nothing is, doesn't refer to anything. That's the point of nothing, right? There is nothing like that. So nobody gets into it. There should always be something, right? So you're at the brink of that. So that's the first thing, is the extreme preciousness and rarity of the human embodiment, where you feel that you are a valuable piece of equipment. You're part of a valuable infrastructure. And what is now my purpose in that infrastructure? And then the second thing you reflect on, I hope everyone's meditating now, rather than worrying. Stop being anxious and meditate. And the second thing is that I'm going to die. If you want to get in the moment, reflect on the certainty that you're going to die. And again, when you meditate on these things, you don't just go, I'm going to die. Or I'm precious, or something. You don't do that. You evaluate whether you think you're going to die. And because at first you say, what do you mean? I know I'm going to die. But then, do I live like I know I'm going to die? No. I'm postponing. I'm going to go on retreat. I'm going to meditate after I retire. I'm going to do this late. I'm going to do that. I'm going to do the other. I'm going to buy my party. Whatever. No, I'm going to go be a robot in Ray Kurzweil's lab. And there's a big freezer in Los Angeles. Did you know that? Walt Disney can be quick frozen. So your body can be quick frozen. And Walt Disney's body is quick frozen. This big place in Los Angeles, they have backup generators in case of a power failure. And he's waiting for the download into the better robot. And it's going to be Mickey Mouse robot or something. And if you can't afford the cost of that, like Tim Leary actually. I visited him just before he died, and he was luckily the nicest visit I ever had with him because he was asleep. So I didn't talk to him. But there was a box, but the box wouldn't fit the body, just the head. So at the moment he was death, they were going to hack his head off your picture, put it in the box. Then he was going over just the head, the brain, you know, filled with some residue of acid and whatever he did. It was going to be put in the frozen box. But he made a fatal mistake. He had a copy of my translation of the Book of the Dead right next to the box. Oh. So then he called me at 3 a.m. before I took a 5 o'clock flight back to the city. And he said, come over, we didn't get a chance to talk. I said, that was lucky. And then I said, but since we are talking, I have to just tell you one thing. And I'm only doing it because I saw you had the book. And that is, you really won't be happy when your consciousness is still around your body and somebody comes and hacks your head off and sticks it in a freezer. Your useless, rotting brain. You're not going to be happy, and you don't need to go in a robot. You're going to have a nice new, and maybe you won't be Irish next life, but you'll be cool. No, don't take that away from me. I said, I'm not taking it away from you. I'm giving you a chance to avoid a trauma at the moment of death. And then he didn't do it. And then he sent them home. But they say, or maybe he couldn't pay, I don't know. But I shouldn't digress. I apologize. So meditate on them. Meditate on your being precious, and then meditate that we do live in denial of death. We act like we're always going to be running around in this robot, in this machinery, in this mechanism. And then, next step on that, on death, is we never know when. It could happen everywhere. Every night I drive home from here, or every time I drive to the city, you're going past another mechanism of a machine of death, you know, a few inches away. Somebody could have a heart attack and just go over the line, and that's the end, right there. It can happen any second to anybody. And we all know that in our instinctively, but in mind we don't know that, and we therefore don't live in the moment. Then, in the moment, if you not think, then the thing about being reborn or being continuum of your soul, your subtle mind, your consciousness, whatever you want to call it, then you think about being nothing versus being continuing to be something, which my dear friend over there is so scared about, doesn't want to, and thinks, because it's comforting to be nothing, at least it's, and there's anesthetic when they pull my teeth, you know, then I won't feel it, you know, so that's, it's comforting to being nothing. But think about it, is there evidence anything can be nothing? And then that will weaken that conviction. And then, is there evidence that there is continuum? Yes. Thousands of millions of people have remembered previous lives and do so all the time. And they have, even the physicists have a theory that no energy is ever destroyed. And your consciousness is some kind of subtle energy, definitely. We know that. We know it's processing things, it's doing things, kind of energy, you know, consciousness is. Maybe we can imagine there's a place that doesn't do anything in the back of it. That's us. But that's obviously irrational. You know, because it wouldn't be able to register anything. Because it would touch it and it would change. You know? So it can't be an unchanging thing, even though we feel gut-wise that it is. So when you feel that, then you realize that whatever I have integrated in my deepest, most subtle layer of consciousness of generosity, patience, tolerance, love, wisdom, openness, etc., the ability to, which is the ability to let go, all of those things are at that deepest place. That's what goes along when I leave the body. And then you become very motivated to do something about that. So then, you then think about the causality of how you evolve, the causality of evolution. You look at Buddha's Darwinian theory. You know, the people in Texas, the creationists, you know, who, you know, have you ever seen, they have a diorama in San Diego, you know, the fundamentalists. How the earth is 6,000 years, maybe 5 or 6,000 years old, because that's what the 6 days of God's creation meant. Each was 1,000 years. They expanded to some concession to geology, you know. But bigger geology of millions and billions of years is Satan, you know, they think. And then they have a thing in that geo thing. For Adam is a white guy with a sort of reddish blonde beard. And he's in somewhere in Kenya, and he's lying on the side like this. And he has like a slightly pain in his rib. And he's lying there. And he looks like a white Texas guy. And of course, he's got a little something, or it's like, you know, privates or something. And she isn't around. The rib walks off somewhere to prepare to wash the dishes or cooking or something. And it's just totally wacky. And they don't want to be connected to monkeys. They don't want to be connected to black people. The males don't want to be connected to female people. That's why they're so frightened of all this transgender and all this, right? So they just want to be white God, white Jesus, white them. Oh, in Africa? Well, it's okay, I was in Africa, but I still was white. It's ridiculous. People in Asia from Buddha's time, they not only are not freaked out about being connected to monkeys, they all personally were monkeys. And they might be monkeys again, and that won't be as much fun as being human. And so that's not a big threat for them. But the weird thing about it is that the mind hops from life to life, along with genes. Changing in species and adapting to environment. There's one other gene, which is the mind gene. And that's been evolving. And that's a biological theory. It's a biological theory where the mind is part of biology. So when you learn the rules of that biological theory of how to shape your mind to evolve in a positive direction, you realize how difficult that is. You then no longer are looking for a bigger apartment in your future life. You know, move from Lexington to Fifth, next to the park, and have like more square feet. You no longer think that because you'll still be miserable in the bigger apartment. You realize that you can't. So then you want to get nirvana, and first you do it as a dualist, to escape somewhere. And later you do it as a bodhisattva to bring all beings in. And now I want to talk about the bodhisattva. So now stop looking at me and meditate, okay? I have to set that preliminary because in a way you can't get anywhere. I'm sure the therapist's first problem is to deal with people's self-contempt in our society, where they don't think it's worth to make a mental effort to really get in there, even they're wealthy or whatever they are, because somewhere deep there's a feeling of self-loathing and self-contempt. And believe me, that thing about Sharon discovering Dalai Lama, I didn't know what it was. Dalai Lama's just playing them. They know perfectly well what it is. They totally know about self-contempt. But their society was not so crazy as ours. So maybe their mothers were good enough mothers in a way, maybe more naturally, you know, in a nomad tent out there with the axe, you know. Because they had to be in their tent, you know. They had to be good enough, you know. And they couldn't be carrying that baby and fussing with it all the time and worrying about getting it to preschool and studying math at 2 because they had to go and milk the yak, you know, the result. You know. Anyway, never mind. So now meditate, okay. Please, go into meditative mode. And then just for fun, try on the idea that you had infinite previous lives, which I just collapsed in a very short scope of thing, but it's very important. It's because it puts you, at least intellectually, theoretically, into a sense that maybe I am entangled in causality and have been forever and will be forever, and my present condition of entanglement where I'm reviewing what it means and finding a purpose in my present infrastructure and my present equipment of my body-mind complex is something really precious to find the purpose of it. You know, myself, understand it, not just follow this and that authority. So that's really important preliminary. Now, if, trying on for size, I've been infinitely alive, and it's not been that satisfactory because I'm not feeling that safe, and I'm feeling very sensitive, and I am vulnerable to pain, and I worry about it, and I'm anxious about it, and I'm addicted to the notion that there must be a place apart from it, and I want to get apart from it. And maybe I can, you know, but maybe not. But anyway, I'm concerned about that. Then suddenly realize that everyone else is in the same position. And not only that, but given the infinite past of you and everyone else, you and everyone else have been in every conceivable interrelationship. Because once things are eternal, infinite, endless, beginningless, you can't say this and that didn't happen. It's impossible to exclude that. And you could have been married to the previous life of Hitler, of Putin, of even Trump, even you were a migrant from Central Europe. You were, you know, you've been everything to everybody, and there's no point to remember when you were all enemies or when everybody else ate you for breakfast or when you ate them. That's kind of useless. That was not fun, you can immediately know. But the thing to think about is everybody was your mother. Every single person. And, you know, everyone therefore has overcome the primal hatred that everybody has to everybody else in their unconscious fear and anxiety about what the other will do to them. And, you know, that Winnicott beautifully puts even in the human being, the human mother, but as you said, that is just to show the amazing transcendence that the mother does love the child, that the mother keeps the child, that the mother has her chest explodes in milk for the child. The milk of compassion, the milk of human kindness, right? Shakespeare. So you then suddenly, everyone was your mother. You sort of, and this is called, and you visualize this in the meditation field. Remember, we said at the beginning, but I didn't remind you again and again because I was too interested in other things, we all were, but it's never mind. But you know, you're in a field of infinite numbers of enlightened beings in their Obi-Wan Kenobi subtle bodies all around you. And they are all urging you forward and supporting you and sending you energy and light, which they draw from the infinite vacuum, zero point field, pulsar, black hole, whatever you want to call it. Clear light of the void is what they call it in India and Tibet. And so you have the tremendous support, and they're radiating light to you. And around you are all the other beings. You know, you visualize them because you are interwoven with them, and they they are, they feel what's felt in your mind subliminally, like you subliminally resonate with whatever's in their mind. You get their vibes. So they're getting your vibe, and you're meditating. And now you're meditating with the shock that everyone has been your mother. And this is the first step of developing universal compassion. It's called mother recognition. And you start with the loved ones who love you in this life, and you love them, therefore, because you feel there for you and you for them. And you see that look of the Laga mother, you know, who's overcome her aversion to this pain-causing creature, this little thing, and yet she's feeling it is the greatest thing in the earth, this little junior. But Oprah said they all look like Winston Churchill. And this little Winston Churchill. And they all have that gaga Google look in their eye. They all have that toward you. And you meditate on that. And you try to recognize that mother look in every being. But they make it, actually when I first learned this, someone didn't tell me that you visualize all the animals and the insects in their temporarily in human form when you visualize them and try to recognize them as your mother. So I was really having trouble with the mother praying mantis and the mother tarantula. I was having a real problem with that, seeing the gaga Google look from the mother tarantula. And maybe she has it because she's going to eat the baby or whatever those insects are that eat their young. And she thinks it's delicious in that sense. That the human thinks its life is more important than hers. And that's the look. That's the Google look, gaga look. Okay. So then you do that. And if you've worked on the preciousness of your life and your beginninglessness of your life and your ability, therefore, to identify with all creatures, and you already have a sense that that's your consensual common sense reality, and on that basis you have a great esteem for your current human embodiment, and you really feel it's precious, and it's to you and to everyone, and you really want to make the most of it, make it meaningful, find its true purpose, that it doesn't have one given by some all-powerful being. It doesn't have one. You have evolved. But it has one for you, which is to find true, safe happiness. And if possible, share that with your loved ones. That's your purpose. You adopt that as your purpose. You know, really make that your eternal purpose, not just temporary. So, because you realize you're stuck for the future, too. So you really try to recognize the motherliness of, and then eventually you work to the neutral people, and then eventually you work to your enemies. And you try to find, even that one looks at you with eyes of hatred and loathing and hostility and aggression. But somewhere in it, that person looks at somebody with that motherly or fatherly look. And so you try to find that look and imagine it as being toward you, even in the enemy. That's the mother recognition meditation. So just imagine that you're doing that. Then the second step, and then if you do that actually, in a few weeks actually, especially in the field of feeling the support of the medicine Buddha and all the Buddha, Shakyamuni Buddha, all your teachers that you've ever had in your life, all the people, maybe your parents if you like them and you learn from them, or one of them, or your mentors of any kind, and they're all around you, Obi-Wan Kenobi, subtle body, luminous energy field supporting you. You can reach it very quickly, actually. It creates a space that is really good for analysis. In this case, of course, you're trying to analyze yourself. And you're not only trying to analyze, you're trying to shape your positive feelings and orientations. And the second step is to remember your mother of this life. And, you know, an exceptional person who would have come to even doing this meditation must have had a mother, however neurotic she may be later, however many personality struggles, like Louisa Gluck having her fall out of a tree and then the tree having served its purpose. It's so far out. And Tibetan lamas, when they teach this to Westerners, they freak because a lot of people complain, I don't like my mother, you know, like she was a big pain. So never mind, there was some primal thing. She at least accepted you in your womb. She went through the terrible pain of giving birth to you, even with a spinal block. It's a wrenching thing. Your body has to wrench itself open. Unbelievable. My wife said it was like having a giant tooth extraction from the middle of your spine. And really, And at the time I was president, I was asking for a spinal block for myself. Natural forgetful. And so now you remember the mother of this life. And you quickly can get back, actually, to what you can get back in analysis when you keep thinking about it. Or you will remember. Some of people naturally do, actually very relatively few. But you can remember being the helpless infant. You can remember the, sort of the face of adoration and anxiety and whatever nervousness in the mother's face. And that gaga look. And you'll feel held at the breast and everything. And really feel how you reproduce that feeling. It's called the Dwindemba, the remembrance of kindness. And you were helpless for a decade, at least. And certainly for a few years, completely helpless. And you were totally depending on the kindness of strangers. You didn't know these parents, really. You didn't really know them. But somehow they helped you in your helplessness. And they fed you, and they cleaned you, and they cuddled you. And by stroking you, your brain developed, etc. You know, there's those studies about you have to be held physically for your inner nervous system to develop properly. The disaster of the orphanages of the 30s, 40s, and 50s, where they wouldn't hold anybody because of germs. The nurses. And that made them mentally defective, unfortunately. And the babies. Anyway, so you remember that. And you get moved, and then they say when you reach the kind of climax in that, or the point of achievement in that meditation, you will feel tears. You might cry. You will have like hairs rising up the back of your neck, and kind of like a thrill feeling in your brain of excruciating, like, how can anybody be so kind, you know, of that sentimentality. A real, true sentimental gratitude. You will feel intensely. And remember, you put that on the overlay of seeing all beings having been your mother like that. So, you know, you have a vision. You could describe, I would describe the vision that I briefly had. Of course, I lost it. But a vision of yourself as being connected with all life by delicate skeins of blood and milk. You know, red and white, delicate skeins of you being connected like that, all enfolding you. Flowing back and forth with beings, because your mother shared her bloodstream with you, actually, before she shared her milk with you. And they all did, actually. So you get very moved in the second thing, and you diffuse that being moved to all beings. And the third thing, then, is another aspect of gratitude, the active aspect, where you, jinsoa, it's called in Tibetan, where you want to repay the kindness. And it's like you know, your elder parent or your old mother in this life who's, you know, like, you know, you want to take care of her. And no, in most societies, you do take care of the elderly, and you feel very, you know, special about them. Sometimes they because you have to work all your life long in this oligarchic economy that we're in now, maybe they have to put them in a special care place, if they're especially non-functional, but which was horrifying, actually, to some people in simpler societies, that you would put a parent like that. But we do, we have to, it's the poor structure of our society, and even we're wealthy. And so you go into, I really want to do something for them, and what is it that I want to do? I don't want them to suffer pain. I don't want her to be unhappy. You feel very compassionate toward them, your mother of this life, and again, you diffuse that over all beings about whom you're so moved because they did this for you, and because you took what your mother did for you. You have remembered it, you have visceral experience it, you can sort of start, if you can't remember, by what you did for your child, if you've had one, or what your friend, married friend, or your single mother friend, or your married mother friend, what she did for her child, whatever you're aware of that, whatever you observe of that, you know, sacrificing all the self-indulgences to indulge this other one, and how kind that is, actually. And then the fourth step is, then they call it the step, so then you get that, where you really want to do something. And then when you really want to do something, you then sort of imagine all these mothers being actually happy. And they say that's the step called lovely love, pleasant love. And in that step, like the eyes of love, you know, the beloved seems beautiful in the eyes of love. And so all those beings, you see their happiness. You see whatever little fraction or fragment of happiness they have. Maybe they are suffering old age, arthritis, whatever it is, but, you know, Alzheimer, whatever it is, but somewhere there's still some vestige, and you only see that, you see the lovely part in the fourth step. Because love so much wills the happiness of the beloved that the beloved looks beautiful when you love it, when you love the beloved. And you that's the feeling of love, and it makes you happy to see them happy. And so that's the love meditation is where you also feel happy. But then the fifth step is what's called compassion step, where you then say, well, okay, I can see they could be like that. I can see they have an element of happiness maybe in their cells, maybe in their toes, maybe somewhere in between when they're asleep, someplace they have it, and I want them to have it everywhere, and do they have it everywhere? And then you look realistically at the state of the mothers and you see they're really unhappy, and they're very worried, and they're depressed, and they're anxious, and they're addicted. And you feel very, very, what can I do about that? I've got to do something about that, you feel. And then sixth step, you come from that, where you think, well, there is Jesus, there's Buddha, there's all kind of Krishna, there's all kind of supposedly loving forces in the universe, and they're supposedly doing everything that can be done for all beings, but they don't seem to be getting it done for the ones that I'm imagining and ones seeing and that I relate to around me. So I'm going to do something myself. And here you develop what's called high resolve, in English, adhyashaya, sort of, actually more technical expression for it might be a messianic determination, a messianic resolve, I'm going to be the one who's going to make them all happy, type of thing, which makes you feel a little crazy. The sense of achievement, the sixth step, is where you feel a little crazed, because it's such a huge thing, facing all of human suffering, as you are visualizing and imagining in this thing, but yet you push through and you say, I'm going to do it for any being that I perceive that is suffering. I'm not going to have compassion, fatigue, that Carl Sagan referred to. I'm going to do that. That's sort of the sixth step. And each of these steps, of course, they all are fitted together. It's like you pull up each step into the next. Mother recognition, kindness, remembrance of gratitude, repayment of kindness, gratitude, lovely love, total compassion, and then messianic determination. So they're all six all together. And you kind of feel a little bit crazed. And then, in order to do that, you have to, in a way, that then here you kind of need a little faith, as Sharon said. And here's where you do need the idea of the infinite transformability of life. And you have to be open to the possibility that there could be a being that is totally empathetic, totally loving, totally selfless, in other words, enlightened, that there is some sort of further evolution of like a monarch butterfly to come out of the cocoon of the semi-self-centered defense mechanism addicted, like separate, like egocentric person, and that there is an enlightened one, and that one is the one who can really help others, and you're going to become that. So then you kind of calm down with that, or, shall we say, you turn that intensity into, I'm going to become a Buddha so I can help all these my mothers. And then this leads to the Bodhisattva, what's called the spirit of enlightenment, the Bodhisattva spirit. People say the Sanskrit word bodhicitta, and they think that they know what that is, but they it's silly using the Sanskrit word. It means the sort of feeling of you're going to imitate a Buddha, you're going to become one, and before you become one, you're going to try to do like a Buddha, be compassionate. Be preoccupied with others. Be altruistic. You're not going to be self-preoccupied. You're going to diminish gradually your self-centeredness, your self-preoccupation, and you're going to be preoccupied with others. And you're going to forget about yourself. And then you rush off to read Shantideva if you're smart. the guide to the Bodhisattva way of life. The way of the Bodhisattva. Or there's a bunch of translations by the great Shantideva. So this is the compassion thing, and this is according to the Dalai Lama. This is the real cure for depression and for anxiety and for addiction. Or in a way, it's kind of like a shifting of the addiction to others. You're addicted to others' happiness rather than your own. And it seems at first crazy. And actually, people hate it who are in rebellion against some kind of religious, including Buddhism, Christianity, Islam, whatever it is, who tell you, yeah, or communism for that matter, or even the social religion or what they call civil religion of democratic societies where they tell you, you have to sacrifice for the whole. You have to submerge yourself in the, like they force you to be altruistic. You have to have the dictatorship of the proletariat. and you have to just completely do everything for the people and nothing for yourself. Or you know, you have to love everybody else and martyr yourself, as people misunderstand compassion in religions. And in a way, religions do just tell people to suppress themselves and force yourself to be altruistic. And this is not that. This is rather much reinforced by all kinds of psychology, by analysis of aesthetic experience, actually. Even art stuff, you know, aesthetic experience. Which is that, what is it when you feel rapture, when you feel bliss, when you feel blown away? What is blown away? What is blown away is your self-concern, your self-preoccupation. Because what is it that you don't enjoy something? When you're sitting there thinking, how much am I enjoying this? Whenever you do that, and is there something else I'd be enjoying more? Or could I enjoy better some other way? When you're like that, you're not enjoying it. You're discontented. Mm-hmm. You know, how happy am I? Oh, not happy enough. That's automatic. So the key to constant dissatisfaction, to constantly living is the first noble truth, only suffering, is to constantly be thinking about your state. How am I? Am I happy or not? Is this good enough or not? Could it be better or not? When you do that, you're going to be dissatisfied, for sure. So initially, although you can't necessarily see through the self instantaneously, discover your selflessness as a fact, not as a moral injunction, but as a fact, and therefore discover the joy of your total interwovenness with everybody else, at least you can imitate that by just being concerned about other people. Well, are they happy? And then somehow forgetting whether you are or not. Then the first person who's happy when you're thinking about another person's happiness is you. You may just go bother them and say, well, I think you should do this, and you'll be happy, and then that's just annoying. But actually, by not thinking about your own because you're focused on them, then you're temporarily ignoring your unhappiness. So you're temporarily better and feeling more content. And in a way, you know, like the mother simulates happiness to make the baby happy. It's like you're playing theater about it. You're doing a, you know, I bet there's a way he analyzes that kind of thing. You know? And here you're the mother of all beings. You're aspiring to be the mother of all beings, which is a Buddha. And you are going to imitate it from the moment you make that aspiration. And you're not, and you're, it's not, it's considered insane. But to have a messianic complex is, I think, it probably in the DCM book, or what's called DSM book, DSM. I'm sure it is. And, you know, your shrink will say, well, okay, I know there's a nice home up there just outside the city where you can go, and you can save all beings, and you'll be next to, you know, you know, Jesus and Mary and St. Peter, they're all over there. You know, maybe Buddha's there, too. You know? And they'll think, because you're crazy, but why? You can't save all beings if you're all going to be dead and nothing. You're only living this life, you can barely save your relatives or yourself. But if you're going to be entwined with all beings in the future forever, then you might as well try to make, to optimize everybody and yourself. And therefore, you might as well try to make them all happy. And with those that you'll fail to deal with in this life, you'll come back with them in the next life. And then you'll try to be their mother, the mother of their happiness at least, in another life. So this is the, no one can leave Menla without being introduced to this seven-step sort of ladder to altruism, because developing altruism is the way to overcome depression. Getting out of the self-enclosure and the vicious cycle of just enclosed in yourself, and I'm so, and no, it's not good enough, and nobody cares about me, and it's not worth it, and that's just a terrible life, and et cetera. And then the deadly, deadly, another deadly side effect of the materialist, nihilist, spiritually nihilistic view. The deadly one is that by killing myself, I'm going to get out of my problem. That's really deadly. The suicide rate, why is there so much suicide in Sweden? A bunch of materialists, mostly, you know, because they're preferable to Lutheranism. Swedes is Lutheranism and alcoholism, you know, which were the two other options, basically, that Nietzsche noticed, you know, in the Northern European thing where there's no sunshine for 6 months, you know. And so, because they think they have the worldview, they have a picture in their mind that there's a nothingness waiting for them, an anesthetic, sleep space, but they at least won't know that everything is so awful, which they're talking themselves into such a state, the state of extreme depression. Okay, so you could say there's a gene involved, there's this and that, you can try all, find all kind of mechanistic gimmicks, but the real cause is the inner monologue combined with the unrealistic, false, blind faith ideology that you can be nothing, that you can solve your problem by the ultimate heroin, which is to shoot yourself. Not an injection, but a bullet. Inject yourself with a bullet. Or sleeping pills, or whatever it is. And then your problems are over. Far from it. You know? That was a great thing Robin Williams did. What dreams may come. Did you ever see it? Where he saw his wife commit suicide, and it's a whole story how he tries to get out. Of course, very Catholic thing, you'll get out of hell, because, you know, people, you know, they tell you you're going to go to hell, which is just trying to scare you out of not killing yourself. You know? And automatically, like, you know, somebody wrote, oh, you're going to be, you know, they book you to hell if you kill yourself. But that's, they're trying to help. It's kind of a stupid way, because it's over a thing, and then the family freaks, and then the person who shot themselves, and who's having a shock, and they're having, in the Bombardo state, and they're running around, they're really pissed off at Carl Sagan, and Daniel Dennett, and Richard Dawkins, because I'm not nothing, where am I, what am I doing here, that's what they feel, and they're all around all their loved ones, for a while, like a ghost, and like, hello. And then the loved one can't see them except for Whoopi Goldberg. She can see them. Whoopi sees them. She does. Did you go to that movie?
I saw it.
So I forgot. But anyway, everyone is your mother. And even Zen, there was a moral moment I have to tell just to lighten it up. That's relax, don't meditate anymore. And Sasaki Roshi, who then at 104 was accused of groping some of his female disciples, and they're really going to nail him at 104. He died at 107. But he was a great teacher. A lot of them got a lot of benefit as well, so whatever. But he was a really amazing person. But one time, at one of our summer schools in Amherst, American Institute of Buddhist Studies, we were doing that next to Barry there. You know, we were trying to provide some content. And certain people didn't like that, but never mind, I won't get into that. But he was giving a lecture on the Diamond Sutra, one of the Prajnaparamita Sutras. And there was a lady in the front row who had a little table like this in front of her, which they gave her. She said, can I have a table for my tape recorder? Oh, yeah, sure. This was at Hampshire College. And he was teaching, he always spoke Japanese, and Tai Uno was translating. And he was going like, you know, one is a diamond, and emptiness, and all this, and one is one, two, really, he was like, and he was this little guy. He looked like a little pug dog, but he didn't have a black face. He didn't have a white face. But he looked like a pug, that guy. And he would go around and like this, very tiny, you know, but really deep, you know. And this lady was like not in the moment because she was taping it. She was getting it, but only on her tape recorder. So she wasn't really paying attention to what he was saying, because she was kept fussing, and the tape recorder didn't work well. It's an old, you know, cassette tape, and click, 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 all the time. He was getting more and more irritated with it. He's looking at her, it's going back and forth, and, you know, Diamond Sutra, and the sixth patriarch heard it, he became enlightened, etc. There's this diamond realm. He didn't say clear out of the void, they don't use that expression, but he mean that. And then finally, he came to sort of a climax toward the end of the lecture, and he said, and so, in fact, everything is fine, and all is good, and one is not one, and two is also one, but the one itself is not one. It's all infinite, we're all interconnected, and I don't need a diamond, therefore, that Richard Burton gave Elizabeth Taylor. I don't need that kind of diamond, and it's all a diamond, and you are my mother. And he flung himself at the table and the lady. This little pug dog, like a right guard in a line. He didn't have any armor on. And he flung himself, the table was flying, and he and the lady, and because she was sitting in the crowd with lots of people, and they all went rolling together. And he made his point of their oneness. You know? He wasn't groping anybody, he was just trying to sort of break through to really make connection with her, you know, and get the tape away. And I happened to be in the back of that lecture toward the end, and I was there. I don't know, and everybody was like, oh, did somebody get hurt? Are we going to get sued? You know, what's the story? We're in Pedrosia. Are you all right, lady? Are you all right? It was a moral moment. And unfortunately, we never have follow-up. We don't have documentation, longitudinal studies. Anybody who got knocked out of their tape recorder by having a little punk Gizen master flick himself in the middle of the lecture on the Diamond Sutra. What was their experience 10 years later? I don't know. I hope it was good. I hope she got over every sense and got really depressed. She suddenly, like, oh, you know, it's all one, it's a diamond, it's okay. I hope. But that was truly, because, you know, he might have known he could be really soon, you know, someday we could be, he could be, you know, we with our faculty temporarily. I don't know if she got a CEU for the shop. I don't know. Maybe. But anyway, that's whatever he did, wrong or right, he was a really great person. And he was afflicted with this motherly thing toward beings, really. He might have molested a few people, but he was married to somebody.